What's up, everyone? Mark here, and welcome to another episode of Down the Road, where I like to share local stories of historical interest and significance right here in my home state of Rhode Island. Just in time for Halloween, I thought it would be appropriate to remember Rhode Island's own supernatural scare nearly 130 years ago and the strange events driven by superstition and fear that soon followed. We're talking today about the 1892 Mercy Brown vampire incident in Exeter. Before we even get started, I have to take a second to thank you all for just watching today's video. If you're familiar with my channel or this series already, then welcome back. And if you're new here, then welcome for the first time. If you're not already, then I really hope you'll consider subscribing to the channel. It's free, it helps me grow the channel, and it shows both me and YouTube that you're interested in the type of content I'm making. Just hit the red button below the video or the watermark in the corner, and when you do, make sure you tap the bell to get notifications whenever I release new videos. Now, when it comes to vampires, you may be surprised to learn that even in modern times, there are plenty of believers out there. According to a 2019 YouGov poll, nearly half of Americans believe in vampires, demons, or some combination of the two, and more than 1 in 10 believe in other sorts of supernatural creatures. The modern day concept of the charismatic blood-sucking vampire didn't even come about until the mid-19th century. Formed by a mix of superstitious beliefs and cultural traditions, this image would later become cemented in the horror genre with Bram Stoker's 1897 novel, Dracula. During Mercy Brown's lifetime, however, the concept of vampirism was more broadly defined as the stealing or feeding of vital essence or life from the living by any sort of undead creature or manifestation. I say concept because the word vampire was rarely, if ever, used in common practice, and was more often applied in the media and entertainment of the day simply to sensationalize and exploit. The reality is that not a single use of the word vampire has ever been directly ascribed to the Exeter villagers themselves in the Mercy Brown case. In the late 19th century, tuberculosis, or TB, was a significant public health threat, though wildly misunderstood. In fact, it wasn't until 1882 when Dr. Robert Koch announced his discovery of the Myobacterium tuberculosis bacteria at a Berlin medical conference. Before it was recognized as a bacterial infection, it was largely thought to be hereditary, and a number of superstitious causes were posited and gained traction among the general public. At the time, tuberculosis killed 1 out of every 7 people living in the United States and Europe. If that sort of death toll occurred today, it would wipe out close to 50 million Americans and more than 100 million Europeans. Even 10 years after Dr. Koch's discovery, the cause of TB was unfortunately not common knowledge everywhere. As is still the case today, more rural, disconnected, and poverty-stricken communities were at a disadvantage when it came to access to things like education and knowledge of new discoveries in science and medicine. Largely absent the medical knowledge needed to explain tuberculosis, some took to believing that it was caused by a vampiric or life-draining undead influence within the stricken's immediate family or friends. The disease's symptoms of weight loss and a chronic cough with blood caused people to believe their loved ones' lives were literally being drained away or consumed, leading to consumption becoming a common AKA for tuberculosis. George Brown had already lost his wife Mary Elizabeth and oldest daughter Mary Olive to TB in 1884, when in 1891 his daughter Mercy Lena and son Edwin also contracted the disease. When Mercy died at age 19 in January 1892, friends and neighbors began to suspect that one of the dead family members was undead and the cause of the illnesses. Edwin was heard to shout things like, "She was here, she wants me to come with her, and she haunts me in his sleep," presumably during fever dreams and nightmares. This only fueled suspicions. It's said that George wasn't a superstitious man, and he didn't believe the theories himself. Whether he believed or just succumbed to social pressure is unknown. However, he was persuaded to give his permission for the bodies of his late wife and daughters to be exhumed, and so they were on March 17, 1892. The bodies were examined by a group including a local doctor, a newspaper reporter, and of course a mob of villagers with interest piqued. There were a number of conclusions drawn based solely on the condition of the bodies. Because Mary Elizabeth and Mary Olive's bodies showed an expected degree of decomposition, they were ruled out as the cause. Mercy's body, however, was found to show almost no decomposition and still contained liquid blood. Further still, her body had turned on its side in the coffin. These were taken as clear signs that Murphy was a vampire and the cause of her brother Edwin's condition. What happened next is a little bizarre. In accordance with the superstitions of the time, Mercy's heart and liver were removed from her corpse and burned. It gets weirder. The ashes of the organs were collected and mixed with water, forming what was believed to be a spiritual and medicinal tonic, and given to the sick Edwin to drink. Unsurprisingly, absent any real treatment, his condition continued to worsen and he died 2 months later in May. Referred to as the New England Vampire Panic, there were many cases throughout the region over the course of a century in which TB outbreaks were believed to be caused by undead influence, resulting in the exhumation of dead bodies and desecration of the corpses. The Mercy Brown case just happens to be one of the more well-documented, and so a clear tale of the events remains to this day. Among other prominent cases was that of Frederick Ransom in South Woodstock, Vermont, who died of tuberculosis at age 20 in February 1817. As I mentioned earlier, it was largely the poorer and less educated who would believe in the vampire panic, making it unusual that Frederick's father, a wealthy college-educated man, would so fear an attack against his family that he would have his son exhumed and his heart burned on a blacksmith's forge. Even with all of this explanation, you may still be left wondering about at least one piece of Mercy Brown's story. Why hadn't her body decomposed in the grave? And for that matter, why was there still liquid blood? Well, the answers to both of those questions are related to one detail about her burial that I previously left out. As you may recall, Mercy died in January, a cold and unforgiving New England winter month. As was common practice in the days before modern mechanical earth-moving equipment, when graves were dug by hand, coffins would be placed in an above-ground crypt until the spring thaw, when it would again become possible to dig. Even though the top 3 feet or so of soil would freeze during wintertime in a cold New England environment, the soil temperature 6 feet down, the depth graves are buried at, remains a constant 50 to 60 degrees Fahrenheit, or 10 to 16 degrees Celsius, far above freezing, year-round. These warmer underground temperatures tend to be bad for preserving bodies, and so decomposition is fairly rapid. Early forms of modern embalming with chemicals as we know it today were in development, new, and fairly uncommon for most of the 19th century. As for the liquid blood, it was likely just a combination of the freezing temperatures and lack of embalming which caused the blood in the body to freeze, preserving it along with the corpse. As to how the body turned in the grave, it's presumed that the body simply shifted in the coffin as it was being moved. With the lack of embalming, however, it can't be ruled out that Mercy was actually sealed in the coffin still alive. Following the exhumation, her desecrated remains were reinterred in the grave where they remain today at the Chestnut Hill Baptist Church in Exeter. Over time, Mercy Lena Brown's famous story has become the source material for popular literary and entertainment works. When Bram Stoker died in 1897, newspaper clippings about Mercy's exhumation were found in his possession, and H.P. Lovecraft, who lived nearby in Providence, mentioned Mercy in his story, The Shunned House. Today, the famous gravesite has become something of a pop culture phenomenon as a destination for history buffs and all types interested in her story. At any given time, a number of trinkets like toys, coins, shells, cigarettes, and more can be seen surrounding the gravestone, which is protected somewhat from vandalism and theft by iron strapping secured to a cement footing. There's even a guest book enclosed in a weatherproof container for visitors to sign. Looking back at this story and others like it, it's easy to draw parallels to the modern day, where we see just how easily misinformation can spread and how truly destructive it can be. Back then, the stakes may not have been high for the already dead, but today, the stakes for the living are significant. If we can't or won't learn lessons from our past, it makes our future all the more difficult and uncertain. If you're interested in learning more about the story, I've included links to the various references and resources used in creating this video down in the description. If you're interested in visiting Mercy Brown's gravesite yourself, I've also included the location information. Just remember that Chestnut Hill Baptist remains open as a church, and the cemetery remains active, so please be respectful. Thank you all so much for watching today's episode. I really hope you enjoyed it, and if you did, please take a second to give it a thumbs up, or even a thumbs down if you didn't. And tell me what you think down in the comments. I'd love to hear what you have to say. Once again, please consider subscribing to the channel if you haven't already, and don't forget that remembering and retelling Rhode Island's history is important, because Rhode Island's history is our history. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.